welcome into the Junk Drawer, part of the Korked Bass Podcast Network. I can assure you that this podcast is not cake. Or is it? I'm Austin. That is AD. What's up, AD?
Austin Grit. It's great to be here.
Grit. That's Grit. Grit. What's up, Grit?
What's going on, fellas?
Today is July 14th, 2020. What is up, junkies? Guys, the NBA bubble is falling apart. We already, just today, or at least the day we recorded this, Russell Westbrook tested positive. AD for a second thought James Harden tested positive, but it turns out that may have just been a unreliable source on Twitter. Disney World reopened this weekend, despite the fact that Florida is spiking at all-time highs in coronavirus. As it turns out, players can't stay inside the bubble, which we will get to here in just a second. But I got to ask, guys, are sports back?
Sports in bubbles are back.
Okay.
At the very least.
Right. MLS is back. Tournament is back.
Also true. Also well, true.
Mostly. Two teams have already left because of COVID concerns. But everyone else is still there.
I think it's incredible that you can get, now I'm learning about soccer just because there's nothing to watch right now, but the fact that if you don't perform at a certain level, you get relegated. Like yeah. The Cleveland Browns would have to go XFL and then right. AAFL.
Yeah. Which I guess would mean they wouldn't even exist anymore since we can't even keep a second tier football league afloat. But yeah, this like soccer really has it. You people are like, man, how is soccer the most popular sport in the world? That's because literally their entire franchise's existence is on the line, pretty much. Like, imagine going back down to AAA baseball if you are the Marlins, you know?
The owners will always make money in our standard of leagues, but if you had to go play high school football in Maryland somewhere whenever the Redskins lose, like I put so much more value on actual winning. And dude, I'm all about it, man. Bring the relegation on.
What about instead of relegation, like just, you know, baseball team gets relegated to AAA or soccer team, you know, whatever levels below that, football, same thing. What if instead of getting relegated to different leagues, you get relegated to different sports?
Sports.
Wow. That would be interesting.
So like the Browns, you know, say, or let's say like the Detroit Lions go 0-16 or 1-15.
Hypothetically or in real life?
Well, it could be either or.
I feel like Matt Patricia could coach a lacrosse team. He has the look of a guy who could coach lacrosse. And I'm in.
Patricia definitely looks like he was the star lacrosse player on his high school team in 1995.
Football is his second sport.
Yeah.
By nature, yeah.
Yeah, the only reason he couldn't stay thin enough to play lacrosse, so he just became an offensive lineman to where he didn't have to watch what he ate.
It was a smooth transition.
Yeah.
Louis Oosthuizen loses a couple matches and he has to go do long drive competitions or putt on Steph Curry's reality TV show.
Wow.
Yeah, just give me the who's the worst team in the NBA right now? I mean, I know the Warriors have been pretty bad, but
no, it's probably the
but they're not, I know they're not the worst.
Is it the Wizards? The Knicks?
It is the Warriors technically right now. Oh, geez, wow. That would be bad. All right, so imagine the Warriors. It would actually pretty much work out in this case. But the Warriors getting relegated from basketball to football?
You don't put basketball above football.
Well, no, but I'm saying like they just get relegated to another sport.
To a different sport.
Yeah, so
like go-kart racing?
Yeah. So the way you're saying it, Grit, is football will get relegated to basketball. Basketball gets relegated to
football baseball. Into baseball, baseball into basketball into golf, golf into lacrosse into – I'm just saying words.
What about
at this
hockey?
Point.
No hockey in there?
I'm getting there. Give me about five more tiers of sport.
Wow. It's, you know, you just said the Warriors are in last place. You know what really sucks about that?
What?
They, you know, what? They've had injuries all year long. Steph got injured. Clay was injured all year long. They're going to end up with the number one pick.
Oh, my gosh, yeah. They're going to get the next Steph Curry.
Like LaMelo Ball or something.
Oh, gosh.
Imagine that.
If, like, just when you thought you couldn't hate the Warriors anymore, after their three-peat or – no, not the three-peat, but their, you know, their three straight trips to the NBA Finals, just when you thought you couldn't hate them anymore, winning 3 in 4 years is what I should say. They're like, if they go out and get LaMelo Ball and bring LeVar Ball back to prominence, that's going to be the most irritating thing in the world.
Oh, jeez. I can see it now. I can.
Speaking of irritating interruptions, I just want to say this once and then we just say what you want and then we roll on, because I know we're totally off topic already and we just started.
Yeah.
Which, in y'all's opinion, is the most skilled position of the two? An NHL goalie or an MLB shortstop? They do the exact same thing. Which one has more skill?
I think the goalie. Just because of the speed and the flexibility. And
it's right, the reaction time, it's right on top of
right. Like when the hardest ball hit is probably like upper 90s, I would say, like through the infield on the ground.
To get low.
Yeah.
With that top spin.
Right. Whereas like a puck.
What's a hockey puck coming at?
The hardest slap shot in hockey is 108 miles per hour, I want to say, Shea Weber. So I would say probably around 100 would be like the hardest.
Did you
hardest.
Just know that off the top of your head? Did you just pull that stat? Wow.
Yeah.
That's why the junkies tune in.
For stats like that.
That's the kind of stuff like my wife would be pissed at. She's like, you couldn't remember the shredded lettuce at the grocery store, but
romaine hearts.
Right? That's exactly what I had to get. And I constantly get the bags, the premium romaine with the carrots and the like little diced onions
and
in
the
there.
Purple what, stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. She gets so
slaw. Yeah.
I'm like, we're out of the other stuff.
It's lettuce.
That's an easy cop out. That's an easy cover.
It said right. Premium.
So, yeah, right. I thought I was giving her a gift. I thought she was going to give me a big kiss when I got home. She did not give me a big kiss. Kings center Richaun Holmes crossed the Disney campus line to pick up delivery food and must quarantine for 10 days. He's now got like 7 days remaining.
He crossed the line like on the ride, like he was waiting in line for a ride, right?
No. He crossed the line of the bubble. Imagine Field of Dreams. Okay. Remember how whenever who was it? Like, I don't know, Shoeless Joe Jackson or whoever it was, the doctor, when he crossed over the gravel into the dirt, he officially became an old man.
And that was,
that's what we're dealing with this bubble. Richaun Holmes crossed over from the dirt onto the gravel and he was out of the bubble. And I'm assuming sirens went off immediately, like, and he had to be quarantined. And he released a statement today that said, after the initial quarantine period, I briefly and accidentally crossed the NBA campus line to pick up a food delivery. Okay, how do you accidentally pick up a food delivery?
That's just not possible.
No, you definitely, like, how did you even know the food delivery was there? You don't just like sleepwalk to a food delivery. I am currently in quarantine and have 8 days left. I apologize for my actions and look forward to rejoining my teammates for a playoff push. Guys, the NBA, a lot of tweets have been coming out and going viral about how NBA players are complaining about the food. Let me read you a list of the 6 restaurants that the NBA has partnered with to provide delivery service, meaning you don't have to go through DoorDash.
Like it comes right to your room.
Right. Wow. Morton's Steakhouse. That's number one. Palm. Saltgrass, which I don't know what Saltgrass is, but that just sounds fancy.
I didn't know what Sounds palm was good, either. Dude. I didn't know what palm was either, but
Sawgrass has tapas.
Sawgrass sounds like a place that like you try for a couple of weeks to get a table at, and when you finally do, you cancel all your plans just to
Sawgrass has no prices on the menu, but when your bone and ribeye comes,
yeah,
it was like $240.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
And your reservation's also at 5 p.m. because that was the only one you could get.
they charge you after the second glass of water.
Right.
Number four is Del Frisco's, which I've heard of Del Frisco's. Great. Good food.
I've actually been there. I was there once, and I got trapped into adding a lobster tail to my steak, and it costs an extra like... $35. She asked it so nonchalantly. She was like, "Would you like the lobster topping?" And I was like, "Well, absolutely. I'll take the lobster topping."
Like, you didn't get tricked. You're indecisive.
I got bamboozled. I got bamboozled.
You got hoodwinked and bamboozled as bad as Ja Rule did. You knew exactly what you were doing. You just
right.
Do you have lobster imitation topping?
Yeah, what get the Heinz whatever the equipment is from Heinz to A1 steak sauces, get that for the lobster topping.
Yeah, it was the most expensive steak I have ever had. I will just put it that way.
It was one of the best
though, for sure.
The NBA also has the Ocean Air. Again, another restaurant I'm not familiar with, but Ocean Air.
It's one word.
I'm sure that menu is like, yeah, there's no prices on that menu either.
Ocean Air with an E on the end?
Yes, with an E on the end. So you know it's like even more bougie.
So pretentious.
Yeah, just close the page. Don't even look at it.
No
ocean,
accent.
What if it was Ocean, H-E-I-R?
Air. Oh, ocean God. Air.
Ocean yeah. Air. Ocean Air. Not ocean hair, AD.
Yeah, it depends how you look at it.
That would just be gross. But no accent marks. So it's probably not like Michelin star level, but it's, you know, it's definitely a 4.5-5-star restaurant just with the E on the end. And then lastly, Joe's Crab Shack.
Whose list is this? Is this LeBron's favorite restaurants? Why are we
there's no taco shops on there, or else I would have said LeBron's number one culprit. But the Joe's Crab Shack on the how did Joe sneak into this like elite group of just star-studded celebrity restaurants?
That's like Wendy's making it.
It is. But you know who didn't make it? Outback Steakhouse.
Oh, rest in peace.
But they were canceled, so it makes sense.
They are canceled. Yeah, we canceled Outback last week. So I don't know why I said R&P. No, they can't. They're not going to rest in peace. They're going to
Darden.
No. They were the other. They're
Bloomin' Brands.
We're Team Darden.
Okay. Yeah, Bloomin' Brands. Yeah,
they're Bloomin' Brands.
I failed the junk drawer trivia.
No, but yeah, Outback is canceled. If you, sorry, that's just the way it is. That's
just the way it goes.
right after Richaun was canceled right after he was quarantined.
same difference, right?
Yeah, right. These days. He got a tweet from his mom who tweeted, "You can only cross the line for your mama's cooking. And I was not in Florida, sir. # LOL." And then she edited him in the tweet, which is good. And then she says, "Love you, baby." Like,
such a mom tweet, man.
I hope that
a mom had Twitter.
Such a mom tweet, but also probably the last person you want to hear from whenever you break the rules of the NBA bubble, right?
You know you messed up at that point.
Right. Like, I'm sure she's probably DMing him saying, "Look, I'm not mad. I'm just disappointed."
Wait, his mom is DMing him and not text messaging him
She's tweeting at him. She tweeted at him.
Okay.
First of all, mom knows
how the private one, the behind the scene one.
Oh yeah. She's DMing him. Yeah, no, she's not texting him. Probably because he only has his burner phone down at the bubble.
Yeah.
Yeah. the one that they're calling girls on. Did you see that thing that a girl was invited? Like she said, like she was already invited. I've already been invited. She said this season ain't happening.
No.
She said that?
Yeah, she tweeted. She tweeted something like, yeah, I've already been invited to the bubble. This season ain't happening.
Oh, jeez. Like why does she have to put their cover like that?
We haven't even started the season. A lot of these teams haven't even like they're still practicing. A lot of the guys are still coming out of quarantine. Like it's not looking good. But props to Richaun Holmes' mom for trying to get a little virality out of this. You know,
hopefully she knows how to cash in. Hopefully
she knows how to up that clout score.
Yeah.
Clout is a hell of a drug.
Right. Now you're probably wondering why would Richaun do this? Well, probably because Kelly Oubre Jr. tweeted earlier in the day to all my @NBA bros. First of all, he added NBA in his tweet. I don't know why.
No, he didn't. Did he actually at them?
To all my @NBA bros, he says, Postmates delivers to the hotel. You just have to go out and meet the delivery person at the hotel entrance. Security will not hold the fort for you or help you. Yeah, the food whack, but we here for bigger purpose. Hope that helps. And then he hashtags it. Shh.
@NBA.
Right. So then obviously a while later, or I guess 2 days later, the Richaun news drops, which really not even 2 days later. It was because he's already 2 days into his quarantine. So meaning he's been on quarantine for the last 2 days. So shortly after he tweeted this, Richaun got caught, was put on quarantine. And then Kelly Oubre tweeted, never mind, LOL.
So funny. Remember when LeBron was doing all his stuff and everybody was yelling, collusion, collusion. This is the game within the game right there.
Right.
Man. Kelly Oubre, man. Kansas hotshot came out of his way. I mean, that is bold. That is that's incredible. That's mind games right there. That guy's already up 1-0 as far as the bubble's concerned.
But how can he even like? He's not there, right? Like that's why he tweeted that, correct? Like,
yeah,
is Phoenix in?
Like how? I mean, they have. I guess not. But how would he know that? And why would anyone take his advice? Like what? If he's not in Orlando, why would they even like? That makes no sense to me, and I don't feel bad for Richaun Holmes. But the other thing is, how do they catch him? Was like they're all wearing those rings, right? So maybe there's GPS on those.
They've got to be
with an actual bubble, like GPS.
Or I mean, like it's probably not even hard. Just like if you're passing a security guard and walking out, I'm sure the security guard's like. Yeah, we had a guy walk out.
Yeah, he just walked out. Yeah,
yeah. So Oubre Jr. And Holmes used to be teammates on the Suns,
right?
But but the Suns aren't down there. The Suns.
Okay, all right. So they aren't down there. All right.
I don't think so.
I know
My bad.
A couple teams weren't invited, but still. But what? Like, why would you take someone's advice that's not even. Unless he goes to Disney.
Actually,
World
no.
Often.
I think actually.
In
me,
addition to the Magic, the Utah Jazz, Denver Nuggets, Phoenix Suns, Brooklyn Nets, and Washington Wizards are scheduled to arrive Tuesday.
Yeah, the Suns are down there.
Teams arriving on Wednesday, and the final eight on Thursday.
There's only two teams there from the West that didn't get there. So, dude, Grit, you nailed this, dude. It is the game within the game. It is the hey guys, why don't you go get your Postmates? Why don't you go get as much food delivered as possible? Never mind the fact we've got Morton's, we've got the Palm and Saltgrass and Del Frisco's and the Ocean Hare and Joe's Crab Shack.
Dude, I love it.
Joe's Crab Shack.
Go get your DoorDash, bring it in and go break quarantine.
Security won't help you. Like, they won't help you. He didn't say they would stop you because they're like, no, bro. I'm not a cop. They can't keep you here, but no.
Well,
I love it.
They literally won't help you because they probably reported him. They're not helping him at all, actually. They're hurting them. Really?
This is actually, look, Every NBA player is playing checkers. Kelly Oubre Jr. is playing chess. This is incredible.
I'm a fan.
Yeah.
I'm a fan now. I didn't like him in the league, but in college, but I like him now. Let's go.
My question is, what food do you think Richaun needed so bad that he had to DoorDash that he couldn't get at Joe's Crab Shack?
With the extensive.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. It's huge.
Oh, like, look, the one thing Joe's Crab Shack cannot deliver, which I would actually be in Richaun's corner for this, is the atmosphere that is at a Joe's Crab Shack.
You know, pieces of flair.
The dancing on tables when it's your birthday. Yeah, the wacky memorabilia hanging all across the walls, you know?
Joe's Crab Shack's not that place where they put, like, paper bags over your head that, like, make fun of you.
Oh, no, that's Dick's Last Resort.
That's Dick's. Okay, all right, yeah. All right.
No, Joe's Crab Shack is essentially SpongeBob SquarePants if it was an actual restaurant. What?
All right, he was born in New Orleans. I didn't know that. So, was he going for that jambalaya?
Oh, wow. Yeah, that's a good point.
Spicy. Nothing on the menu was spicy enough for that man. I doubt the ocean air has any seasoning in their kitchen. Any seasoning.
Doubtful.
It's a whole bunch of, like, expensive, like, the only seasoning you get on a steak is if you talk an idiot into getting it Oscar'd.
Yeah. And let's be real. Saltgrass's portion sizes are probably a bit too small.
Most likely.
It's tapas. It's tapas. Yeah. It's all tapas except for crab steak.
The one thing I did not notice on the list that I could totally see him going after, and I probably would myself as well, sushi. I didn't see any sushi on that list.
I love sushi.
Man. I mean, and Joe's could make you some sushi. You just have to ask. You just have to, you just have to know what to ask for.
Let me go ask the chef.
Oh, sticking out of it.
They're like, oh, you just need the fish raw? Okay.
Joe himself.
Just a fish with the head still intact.
Let me ask you guys this. What food let's just extend it out to just item. Food and or item. Would you cross bubble lines to risk getting? Like, what would you put honestly, the next 10 days of your basketball playing career in jeopardy for just to get?
Well, like, quick side note, isn't most normal quarantines 14 days? Like, where do they get this 10-day?
Well, probably when you're in – because the bubble itself is its own quarantine. So imagine – yeah. Okay. I mean, and that just goes to Richaun's, like, how ridiculous this is to begin with. Like, he's already in quarantine being in this bubble. So now he's on, like, double secret quarantine.
It's the inception, like, quarantine within the quarantine.
Right.
Like,
yeah. You know, it's like, – yeah. It's the – It's the half a teen, or the eighth a teen.
Yeah. Well, they only took 4 days off, so you have to think there's some sort of math or, like, equation involved to get to that ten number. But
maybe there was a factor of how many feet he stepped outside of the bubble.
Yeah. Right.
Maybe
how
it was
many
10
people
feet.
Did you interact a
foot,
with
foot per day? Maybe 10.
Yeah.
Feet?
For however many feet you go to meet that delivery driver, that's how many days you have to quarantine for.
That delivery driver knew what was up to.
Yeah.
If he took a selfie with him and posted it, you know, that would have been 2 months. Months quarantine.
Yeah, he could have beaten Richaun's mom to virality on this story.
But back to your original question, I would 100% get on my app and I would order 10, that's the number, 10.
Wow.
If you're playing along at home, plates, fried rice, double orange chicken, Panda Express.
That's my
Where they do the fried rice and they got the egg in the fried rice, but eggs got cheap, like, or too expensive like 5 years ago, and they tried to substitute corn like some idiots.
Yeah.
And they went back to the fried rice. That was the only miss. Panda Express, orange chicken. all day.
Fine American dining right there, as we learned last week.
On San Francisco.
Yeah.
San Francisco.
San Francisco treat.
It is the San Francisco treat. Yeah, that's the original rice-a-roni, the fried rice-a-roni.
That's awesome.
AD, what about you?
So
don't say like a pierogi.
Oh, are you having a problem saying it too?
A pierogi. Oh, come on, we got to get you pronouncing that a little bit.
I just know you're gonna hit us with some yinzer answer right now.
You saw the pierogi race at PNC Park, like you're better than that.
I'm not hating on the pierogi. I'm just saying don't give us some only. Like some specific answer to where the yinzers know it.
I won't.
What in the Sam Hill is a pierogi?
Oh, there it is. Wait, Grit, all your time working in and around the Pittsburgh area, you never heard of a pierogi?
I've spent about an hour, maybe a week in Pittsburgh entire life, and that was 84 Grit. Pennsylvania.
You could have spent 5 minutes in Pittsburgh, yeah. And I'm surprised you hadn't heard of a pierogi.
Grit, that is shocking to me. Although I guess it is sort of regional, but it's not sort of regional.
It's definitely regional.
Okay, all right, it is definitely regional. You're right.
It's like St. Louisans being like, oh, you've never heard of toasted ravioli? It's like, no, nobody else outside of this zip code eats toasted ravioli.
Toasted ravioli? Like
yeah,
crunchy
it's like fried ravioli?
Ravioli.
St. Louisans love it. It is good. It's very delicious.
It is really good.
Don't get me wrong.
It is good.
But it's like, it's not, people are like, we make the best fried, you know, best toasted ravioli. I'm like, yeah.
Is that like toasted ravioli? Is that like what's the Chilean, the meat pie empanada? Is that like an empanada? Like a small empanada?
Kind of. It's literally just ravioli that they just fry. Kind of.
I'm in on that.
It's
I don't
good.
Know.
All you
I still
need
don't know what the hell a pierogi
it's
is.
It's an appetizer. So you do like little marinara dipping sauce, but anyway.
Right.
It's tapas, I would not leave man. The bubble. It's tapas.
For toasted ravioli.
Well, I guess a pierogi is sort of similar, actually. I mean, it's really just like you can fry it. It's like toast. I mean, dough. And cheese, a potato and cheese in the middle, or really anything. I mean, you can get really creative with your pierogi. I mean, you
I still
can.
Don't have
do they have
an
dessert
answer.
Pierogies?
What's that?
Do they have dessert pierogies?
Yeah, absolutely. It's a Polish treat. Grit, have you ever heard of Mrs. T's pierogies? Or I feel like that's no. I guess
have you heard of my Aunt Edna?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I just thought they were in grocery stores. I mean, they're just in grocery stores all around here.
Oh, okay. It looks like a dumpling.
Yeah. Exactly. Potato, cheese. Yeah. It's great. You should make them.
It is a dumpling, also known as varinki or filled dumplings.
There you go.
So it's dumplings, man. You guys invented dumplings and gave it a stupid name.
Gave it a dumb name. Yep. I didn't do that. That was Polish people.
AD was like, that was here well before I got here.
They can take credit for that.
AD's like, I'm from Central PA.
Hey, there's
Polish people
Central
make some
PA
great thing, food, man. They make some great food. They do.
They do. Yeah. They
I would
really
maybe
do.
I would maybe break the bubble for some Amish cooking. Some Mennonite cooking.
Pennsylvania Dutch.
Oh. What's Amish cooking like? I've only had their like apple butter and stuff like that.
Okay, so like just imagine like Cracker Barrel food, but like literally like but like if angels made it. Yeah.
A lot of butter.
Like
too.
They all have 6 stars.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
On their Cracker Barrel blouses.
Yeah.
Yes, right. All right, AD, what are you breaking the bubble for?
So I would absolutely break the bubble for a very nice bacon, egg, and cheese on like a brioche bun with a nice black coffee.
Oh, wow.
And I would absolutely, and you know, like it's gotta be cooked right though. Cause you know, some bacon, egg, and cheeses get a little questionable whether the bacon's underdone or like the egg's not cooked right. But it's
one of those where they do the candied bacon.
Oh yeah,
on
yeah.
It
like nice thick cut,
ground it up, and they cook it with that when they're making the bread. Oh yeah,
love a nice bacon, egg, and cheese. The cheese nice melted too, like almost to the point where like if it comes in like a little tin foil thing, where like you're peeling it off and like there's cheese stuck to the side a little bit, and like you gotta like rip it off and take it off. You know, that's what I would absolutely cross the line for.
I'm about to cross the line right now, and I ain't in the bubble.
anywhere that's open closet. That has breakfast. Yeah.
Honestly, literally any breakfast food. Obviously, if you know me, you know anything Waffle House. Like if there was like right. a Waffle House just across the street from the bubble, I would go over there literally every night. And just restart my quarantine over again every single night. But I would say my answer probably to this question, and this is, look, I'm a simple guy, and my wife clowns me all the time for this being my favorite restaurant, my favorite chain restaurant, O'Charley's.
Jeez.
No? We're not at O'Charley's podcast?
I don't know if I've actually been to one, so I can't knock you too hard, but
oh, the rolls there are incredible. No, come on. There's really cheap steaks there. And like they're cheap, but they're affordable.
Free Pie Wednesdays.
Free, yes, thank you. Yes. Great. You know what's up.
Kingston Pike all the time.
Yeah, yeah. Hell yeah. O'Charley's, man. I could really get down with some.
I'm picturing like a Haas's steakhouse type place, like a buffet. They have a buffet. Yeah, it's salad like, bar rather.
They
like
claim
a salad bar, or
they claim they're Irish, but they don't really play into that fact very much.
Just the name,
like,
yeah,
like Olive Garden Italian,
right? Like it's green, yeah. It's green inside, but it's like that's about it. That's where the Irishness stops. But like it's American cooking. It's so good. And it's the steak is great. The rolls are amazing. The Free Pie Wednesday. If you sign up for their emails, they'll send you reminders. Hey, today's Free Pie Wednesday. I kept getting those. I lived in Southern California for 3 years. There's not an O'Charley's in Southern California. I kept getting those emails every Wednesday just to remind me of home, you know?
Did it make you miss it? Did it make you want to go back just for being there on a Wednesday and go?
It did, yeah. A little bit. I would get homesick every Wednesday around the same time that email came in.
Are there any by you now? Like, do you get to go now?
There was one, but it sadly.
Oh, jeez.
R.I.P.
Not the news we needed right now. Jeez.
Not forgotten.
My wife and I went to it once. She was like, you know, I'm, you know, like most wives are like, when they want to give in, they're like, okay, I'm going to give you sex. My wife was like, all right, I'm going to give you in. We're going to O'Charley's. And this I was like, wow.
Your one time. Yeah.
Yeah. I was like, wow, this is a special night.
Only on your birthday.
Yeah.
And it was on, and only when your birthday is on Free Pie Wednesday.
Yeah. Every 4 years.
All right. Wanting O'Charley's as your go-to restaurant is like ordering off the menu at like Shoney's or like any buffet place.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
Golden Corral.
Look, I'm
going to go on menu.
I'll admit it. It's a terrible answer. It's a terrible answer, but I am so, I just love O'Charley's. So I would, and if I was stuck in a bubble, I'd be like, man, I would be craving it more than I would normally, more than I was when I was out in California.
Because you can't have it.
Right. It's how I was in California. I was, yeah. Anyway. Hey guys, the Redskins are changing their name. I don't know if you heard this or not.
Oh, no way.
Yeah, not that many people are talking about it. They're officially changing their name. And I wanted to hit you guys with a take from a guy that I'm friends with on Facebook, okay?
All right. Let's hear it.
God.
This is going to be good. Yeah, I'm excited for this.
He said, yo.
I'm sure he did.
Every good post starts with yo.
Yo, comma, or yo, and he just goes right into it.
No punctuation. This is not a – you got to think that
all
anyone
caps,
starts
all
their –
caps, yo?
No, all
just
caps.
Y-O.
So he's not yelling at us yet.
No, there was one – there is one word that's all caps, and I'll let you know when that comes. He goes, yo, this is wild. And then he says, IMO, in my opinion. And then he goes all caps. He goes, not – Good for sports. A lot more teams will come under fire. This is now the precedent we set. Whole world not chill right now. Good luck. And it was linked to an article about the Redskins changing their name.
Y'all ever watch It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia?
Oh, yeah.
I'm from Pennsylvania.
Yeah. Oh, sorry.
Yeah. That's a requirement there. It's actually state law.
Yeah.
You remember Charlie's speech when he was campaigning, when he was writing Dennis's a speech to be elected like mayor or whatever? And it was just a whole bunch of gibberish that made no actual sense. Vote me. You will. That guy did a worse job than Charlie Day.
Right. Right. Yo, this is wild. In my opinion, not good for sports. A lot more teams will come under fire if this is now the precedent we sent. Whole world, not chill right now. Good luck.
Wait. Could you reread that? But this time – in Liam Neeson's Taken voice, good luck.
Yeah. It's like, got a very
yo,
I've got a very particular set of skills. This is wild. In my opinion, not good for sports. A lot more teams will come under fire. This is not the president we sent. Whole world teams chill right now. Good luck.
Teams take notice. Not very chill right now. Wait, why did I get a little Mr. Miyagi?
Oh, man. Anyway.
Are y'all all right, it's time, right? It's time to get rid of the Redskins moniker,
I'm
right?
This is my take on it. If you're not a fan of the Redskins, what do you care?
Right? Like, is it really affecting you?
Like, right. Like, I'm like, and it, okay, and then let's say, okay, if you are a fan of the Redskins, why are you fighting so hard for a team name that is literally a color plus the word skin? Like, look, I'm not the best at algebra, but that equation right there, it does not equal, to me, a very sensitive, like, terminology. There are some team names, like the Braves. I'm okay. Like, I don't care one way or the other about the Tomahawk Chop. I love the Braves. I pull for them when I'm not pulling for my own team, but their name, like the Braves, like that to me is like a very, like that's
specific.
Kind of like a term of endearment in my, I don't know, maybe I'm wrong. And I'm a white dude. I'm not going to try and claim I know anything about this, but I mean, I feel like that's a name honoring the tradition of the people who owned this land before us. And whereas Redskins seems a bit, I don't know. It just doesn't seem comfortable in this day and age.
No.
Maybe that's just me. But again, I'm
a little outdated. Outdated, I'd say.
I'm not a Redskins fan, so I don't care if they change the name. And I don't understand why people who aren't fans of the Redskins care.
Do you think most people are upset because they have like a bunch of like jerseys or t-shirts and hats and just like have everything on and like,
maybe
I spent all this money. Come on. Like, you know,
sure. And I get that. But also I'm also very hyper aware of the world of nostalgia that we live in. So that would almost be cooler. You know, like if I see someone wearing a Redskin shirt, like down the street now, I'm not like, oh, sweet hoodie, dude. But like, if I see a dude rocking a Redskins hoodie and like, 10 years from now, I'll be like, oh, dude, sweet hoodie.
Even a year from now.
Like, I remember when your team was racist.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Like the Washington Bullets.
Right. Yes. Like nobody batted an eye when they changed their name. Nobody cared when the Bobcats changed to the Hornets. But now all of a sudden people care when the name is literally probably offensive.
So I heard somewhere that the Washington Bullets – changed their name actually because DC was like the murder capital of the world.
Yes. Still is, which St. Louis close second. Shout out.
It still is? Well,
I think so.
I heard someone say, well, why don't we change the Redskins name to the Bullets? And I'm like, well, what? So you want to go back to that? Like I don't, that doesn't make any sense to me. Like,
yeah, probably not the best. That'd be like,
Wizards were the worst jersey in basketball. Matter of fact, I want to get a Michael Jordan, a Bullets throwback, because I think they played in the Bullets.
Jordan never did. Jordan was only with the Wizards. Are you saying that like for like a game that they did?
A throwback game.
I don't think they did, because I think they wanted to tarnish they wanted to get rid of that, banish the logo the and the name.
Yeah. Wasn't it around that time? When did they change to the Wizards? It had to have been.
I think it was like I want to say it was like in 99 or 2000.
Like, and he joined the Wizards, I think, in like 2001
or 2002. Yeah. But anyway, yeah. Do you guys have any names that like you're kind of in the corner for? That's photoshopped. No,
Grit, if you can find that jersey, I think we all need one. So, can we? I'll get that together.
I need that jersey. But like, what do the Braves do? Do they go back to being the Boston Bean Eaters or the Atlanta Bean Eaters, what they were before?
That'd kind of be cool.
I mean, the tomahawk chop, I guess I love it. I've always done it my whole life. Maybe it's got to go. And I guess that's us. Like, it's no longer, and I know three white guys talking about it is exactly what people want to hear.
I know. It's this is honestly the worst right now.
Yeah.
It used to be, and I guess maybe for me in general, not being racist was good enough. Maybe we do need to seek some of these things out and see for like people, but I don't know. Probably not.
Yeah.
What the hell do I know?
It's just
uncomfortable as fuck.
I know is like, I grew up in Nashville. I grew up in the South, and like, I understand like the Braves and how important it is to the entire Southeast, because shout out to the TBS Superstation, you know, like everyone in the Southeast is pretty much a Braves fan, because for the same reason, everyone in the Midwest is a Cubs fan or a Cardinals fan because of the radio reach, the WGN TV reach for the Cubs.
WGN.
Yeah. So like the Braves are a very important team in the Southeast, and a lot of people don't want to go, and I get it. I get the tradition aspect of it, but if the tradition is, you know, I mean, at some point, some of the worst things that we did in this country were based in tradition. And sometimes it's good to move on and maybe start new traditions. And
it's true.
And I,
what again, better I, time than now?
Right.
Right.
Right. Right. And I'm okay with the name, but again, that's me coming from a white guy who has literally no heritage or roots as a Native American. And, if the tomahawk chop, like Ryan Helsley of the Cardinals last year came out and during the playoff series and said, yeah, I'm part Cherokee, and it's very offensive to me and my family. So I'm not going to say that he's wrong. I'm not going to say I can't tell him what is offensive to him or not. And maybe that was just the competitive juices in him flowing or something during the playoffs or whatever. But like, I don't know.
You can do to get an edge as well. Competitivism like that, the game behind the game is important as well.
Yeah, it's like telling someone you can get Doordash at a NBA bubble, you know?
I love it, dude. But there was a stat, and I forget what it was, and I'll have to look it up for well after this podcast, so it really doesn't mean a shit, and I probably won't look it up anyways. But when they asked people in the Washington, in the DMV area, about like, is this name offensive? They took people that identified, but they weren't practicing natives. They weren't practicing in that religion. It was like the Elizabeth Warrens of the world that were doing all that. And they said, no, it's fine. It's not offensive. It's probably one of those fed them, you know, $5 Hardee's coupons or something that. And the numbers aren't right. But if I was in that community, that would be so damn offensive. And the Indians, maybe Cleveland, they got rid of Chief Wahoo.
Right.
The Braves probably, 15 years ago got rid of Chief Nakahoma.
Yeah. Chief Nakahoma they got rid of. So it's like, look, I'm fine with like eradicating just, you know, things here and there and just come up with new traditions, you know, like have new things that allow everyone to enjoy themselves at a ballpark, you know? And that's really what ballparks are about, you know, brings everyone together of different colors and credences and, you know, here I am getting on my soapbox, but it should bring a tear to your eye when you go to the ballpark and just like, yeah, like this is a beautiful thing that we can all enjoy baseball together.
But we're not going to be able to this year. We're not going to be at the games. And do you see, and off topic again, it's my forte. It's what I love to do. Do you see that MLB is still pulling their blackout bullshit with stadium attendance and the MLB packages?
I'm actually going to
get rid of that archaic ass blackout.
I've got a blog that I've been working on that I am going to just unleash hell on Major League Baseball, because
I can't wait to read that.
The dumbest thing. It is like the fact, first of all, even if it was a full season, it's dumb that they still have this blackout rule. Baseball, you are so thick-headed and just you're idiots for not thinking that. I'll say this. MLB Advanced Media was so great with the way, like, they were the first to streaming. They were the first to a lot of different things that in other sports are. But now they're, as these other sports are slowly starting to pass them by, football and basketball they're both more popular than baseball in this country, which is sad. And I think a large part of that is because of these blackout rules that they have for MLB TV. And if I'm in St. Louis, I can't stream a Cardinals game. When I was living in Los Angeles, I couldn't stream a Dodgers game. And not to mention, the Dodgers games weren't even on TV because of the cable packages.
And you couldn't get that cable package, right?
I couldn't get that cable package. Yeah. The same thing's happening in Chicago right now with the Marquee Sports Network that they just launched. It's not being covered on the biggest cable provider in Chicago, because they're button heads and they want to up the costs. And it's just so messed up. And baseball could step in and say, look, we're getting rid of our blackout restrictions, which is an archaic thing to begin with anyway. And yeah, I'm going to freaking raise hell on Manfred. And the fact that they're raising the prices, that's costs. It usually
per
costs
game, per game. It costs game. More this year.
We did this math. Yep. Right. Yep, we did. Yeah.
sorry. No, we might already talk, but like here in Tennessee, Fox Sports South, could get preempted by, the Cardinals. So like I can't watch sometimes my games because the Cardinals game. No, I don't give a fuck about the Cardinals.
Sure.
I can't watch that or on my MLB package.
Right.
Yeah, it's so bad, dude. Get rid of the blackout.
Right. Like, yeah. Like if AD was
so
in,
mad.
If AD was visiting me in St. Louis and the Pirates were in town, he wouldn't be able to watch the game on. Now, granted, he could watch the game on TV, I guess, but he wouldn't
bad
be able
example,
to.
Bad
he,
example.
Well, you wouldn't be able to stream it, I guess, like wherever you wanted to go, which is so dumb to me. Like, you should be able to, this is 2020. You should be able to watch any sport wherever you want to go at any point. And the NFL did that dumb deal with Verizon to where you're only a Verizon carrier. That's dumb. It's just money still speaks volumes in 2020, and it's really hurting a lot of these sports, which is so
an stupid. MLB red zone would be incredible though.
Oh,
right. And that's another thing.
MLB red zone would be incredible.
Why what would you like do that? What would you call that?
Extra innings.
MLB at the plate. At the plate. At the plate.
That's the name MLB, of the
batter's box. Batter's box. Because then you could be like the different boxes, you know, like when they go to the quad box.
Oh.
Octobox.
Octobox.
Who would host it? It would be like A-Rod or like
Austin's boy.
Me?
Yeah, your boy, Jeff. Passan or whatever his name is.
Oh, wait. Good. Oh, Jeff Passan?
He wouldn't be good.
Yeah.
Jeff Passan would be good, but he's a reporter.
Hey, he could host.
Scott Hanson's a nerd. It works.
That's true.
What did Scott Hanson do before Red Zone anyways? He
hosted that To Catch a Predator show.
No, that's Chris Hansen. Chris Hansen.
Okay.
Trust me. Yeah. Trust me. He asked me to have a seat one time. No, sorry. That's not what I'm joking about. Gosh, that's awful. Last, before we move on,
so
real
you
quick.
You brought the wine coolers.
Why don't you
I'll
have
be
a
right
seat?
Out.
That's not what the transcript says.
what was the show? Arrested Development, where Tobias Funke. Oh my God, that was the best episode ever. Daddy's got to get his rocks off. He's got the thing outfit on. You had to be there. You had to be there.
Yeah, right.
Great show, though. Great show.
Great show.
The rest of
quickly, before we move on, one word. What team name are you in the corner for the Washington, whatever their new name is?
I'm with the Washington Warriors. I know it's kind of like a repeat, but I don't know.
Yeah, that's right.
I like the Red Tails, man. I like the Red Tails.
Red Tails is good, too. Yeah. Yeah.
You know, it keeps it, the color system works.
Hail to the Red
it's
Tails.
It's going to be horrible.
Oh, it'll be dumb. It'll probably be like the Washington Daniels after Dan Snyder or something. I want the Washingtons. That way
The Washingtonians.
Yeah, just Washingtons, go Washingtons. And then it's just literally it's the same logo they have now, except you take away like the braided hair, dark hair, and you just throw a white wig on it, and it's just George Washington.
I like that.
A penny. Hey, new segment alert. So last week, you guys remember me telling you the story about my near-death experience with the text message from the future?
From Jeff, other friend Jeff, yes.
The text message
reminded you of it, rather.
No, my friend Frank reminded me of
sorry,
it.
Sorry, Frank, if you're listening.
So Frank was listening last week.
Yes, he was.
And he sent me a text, and he said, "Listen to Junk Drawer, love it." First of all, thanks, Frank. second of all, he said, "I wanted to let you know that the guy who founded Outback Steakhouse is a Kentucky grad." Now, Frank's a massive Kentucky Wildcats fan, probably the biggest Kentucky fan I've ever met in my life, which is like he hasn't missed a game since he was in seventh grade or something. Like, it's ridiculous. He loves Kentucky Wildcats. So he said, the founder of Outback is a Kentucky fan. I was like, oh my gosh, that's incredible. So I decided from that point on, each week I'm gonna give everyone a Frank fact.
Okay. I like that.
And so this week's Frank fact is Bristol, Tennessee is closer to Canada than it is to Memphis. Which is crazy. Oh. That is crazy. Grit, that's your neck of the woods, man. Bristol. Well, I guess sense. No, you're yeah. like what, 2 hours from Bristol, aren't you?
About two, yeah. Probably.
Which is, that to me is crazy. Cause like growing up in Central Tennessee, Knoxville, I always thought was like the furthest east you could go, but it's not. You can go even further and hit Bristol.
Wait a minute.
Which is what I would have to drive through to get up to Pennsylvania each summer.
Damn.
And it would take us 5 hours just to get out of the state of Tennessee from Nashville.
That's blowing my mind a little
Tennessee's
bit.
Tennessee's long.
Frank is racking long. My brain right now. I'm thinking...
All right, so it would take me probably, I don't know, I would never drive to Memphis. There's nothing for me there. Penny Hardaway can go to hell.
Penny, not Lil Penny.
It takes me
Penny,
6 hours and then probably 2 hours. So maybe that 8-hour difference, I'm just assuming. Up 81, it's like 8 hours to get to D.C. And if you come over towards like Ontario side.
Did you say 81?
I don't know, man. I'm going to think Frank's wrong.
Did you say 81?
No, 95. 95.
Okay, all right.
81 hits 95 and runs
81's up. Also in PA. That's crazy. It's a big, must be a big.
It's a long road.
Yeah. Frank is blowing my mind right now. If this is right.
I think Frank's wrong. Guys,
the total driving distance from Bristol, Toronto.
Fact checking Frank?
We are, which we shouldn't be. This is Frank's fact segment. This is his own segment.
We're fact checking him right now.
If he's wrong, it will be the shortest lived segment on this new show.
693. All right. I'm looking this up. All right. So that's to Ontario though. So it is 500 and it is 500 and yeah, right. Great podcasting right here. 502 miles. To Memphis. That's via I-40 the whole way. Straight shot. Well, not straight shot. It kind of, it's like a curve. 502 miles. Okay. So Bristol, Tennessee to Canada?
Yeah. Well.
See, this only gives me Ontario, Canada. Is that the closest?
I mean, you might have to hit the lakes. Who owns the lakes?
There's a Canada, Kentucky to Windsor, Ontario. Let's try that. This is Frank's facts. I'm just gonna side with Frank on this one. I'm not gonna dispute it. That's all I'm gonna say.
You want to know why I think
disputing it? You're wrong, Frank.
Well, you know, we may have to get back to this next episode whenever we get our next Frank facts. But I mean, like, think about Detroit's like right across the lake from Canada, and so is like I think he could be onto something here. Michigan, right.
He's not, dude.
Frank's
no, wrong.
No, oh
Frank's
my gosh.
Red Grit, hot moment is.
Grit, you're only saying that because you know he's a Kentucky fan, and you're a Tennessee
fan. Yeah.
That's the only reason you're anti Frank. That's the only reason, Grit.
Run Bristol to Detroit.
If I told you, Grit was a VFL, you would be like, Oh, dude, yeah, it's. I go to Canada all the time from Bristol. Get there in 3 hours.
Well, most Kentucky fans, they're also New England Patriot fans.
No. He's just like that. He's not. True? He's a,
all that. Yeah.
He grew up. No, he grew up.
Check
no.
and see.
He's a Titans. Might be a Yankee. He's a Titans fan. He's a.
Okay. Say Yankees. Say Yankees.
No, he's not a Yankees fan. He's a.
All right. Baseball team. So there must be a closer point of Canada touching because
it's around the Detroit area. All right.
Why are we spending any more time
on this?
All right.
Yeah,
we need
right.
a coffee
Frank's
break.
Right.
Frank, you started it.
No. And Frank's facts. It's Frank's facts. It's not our facts. if he wants them to be wrong, that's fine. But I'm not one
to disclaimer.
Dispute.
Put a disclaimer. I am one to dispute.
The name itself is a disclaimer. They're Frank's facts. Okay?
I like that he used Bristol, though, because of the NASCAR race coming up there. But we can.
That is true. The All-Star race, yes. Which we apparently just found out was a real thing. All right, great. Coffee break.
All right. Healthy Bean Coffee is a semi-dark, organic, low-acid blend infused with maca chia and rooibos tea. All right, I'm going to tell y'all a recipe, all right? Little Grit got in the kitchen this week, man.
Okay.
Anyone who pressed the 30-second skip ahead button is totally missing
right now. Yeah. Right now. Do 32 ounces of water. Do 3/4 scoop of ground coffee. Put it in there.
Healthy bean
coffee.
Stir
it up.
Healthy bean coffee.
Yeah. Let it sit for 12 hours. Filter it out. Filter all the grounds out and all that. You've got some cold brew, some sipping coffee. Oh, I can't do hot coffee when it's hot out. I got to do my cold coffee. Dude, it is so good. It is a game changer. No sugar, no sweetener, no nothing in it. Healthybeancoffee.com, promo code CORKED. Buy your bag, man. 15% off. Best coffee in the world.
So next time you're smoking your meat for like 12, 13 hours, make a little coffee
Smoke
there on
your
the
coffee.
Side.
Huh? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, guys, we don't have a ton of time, let's get into this. This is literally, there's no segue into this segment. It was just something I thought would be great to talk about on this week's podcast. But the top three movies and or movie scenes that just made you cry. Look, we're three grown ass men on this podcast. But we're not afraid to admit that we can, you know, a good, well-written movie, a well-shot movie, sometimes can really tug at the heartstrings and get the waterworks going, even for us. You probably, when you first subscribe to this podcast, which if you haven't, go ahead and hit subscribe. If you're watching on YouTube, hit subscribe, hit that little bell button too, so you get notified whenever you get a new video from Cork Bats. But when you first subscribed to this podcast, you were probably thinking, man, these are the manliest men I've ever heard in my life.
Well, the hair on their chest.
Yeah, they're probably like, that's not nice. the manliest men I've ever met or I've ever heard in my life, and they probably never cry, even at movies. No, we're here to tell you you're wrong. Sometimes we do. And we're gonna share with you those movie scenes that make us cry. So if, like, you know, look, quarantine's been tough. 2020's been tough as a year. Maybe you just need a good cry. Just let it all out. Why don't you watch some of these movies and we'll tell you. So, AD, why don't you go ahead and start us off your top three movies and or movie scenes that just make you cry.
I'm listing all three right now?
Yeah, just go right off the bat.
All right. So, my number one pick, I'm going with probably one of the saddest movies.
No. Start number three. Countdown.
All right. Number three, coming in strong. I've got The Notebook.
That's good. Any part in particular?
Well, I mean, I hate to talk about it, but the part at the end, you know, whenever they're old and they die in each other's arms, it's so beautiful. I'm getting a little teary-eyed talking about it right now, but it's beautiful and it's a great love story. You know, it really is. And it gets me every time. Every time I see it, doesn't matter where I start watching that movie, that part will get me.
the notebook is the reverse up. It's the down. It's
like it is.
It is like they waited till the end for the old couple to die. You know, it's like, hey, take some notes, Pixar. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. Let's not get that out of the way in the beginning, right?
Right. Like, yeah. Hey, spoiler warning. 5 minutes in. The old lady was dead the entire movie. It's like the Sixth Sense.
Sixth Sense.
Yes, yes.
Spoiler alert.
Super spoiler alert. So number two has to be probably one of the first movies I think I've ever cried at. And it was watching it as a little kid. It was The Lion King. Mm. When Mufasa dies, Simba's going up to him like, dad, you know, like, it's just
get up.
And then right after that, you know, he like cuddles in next to him, Scar walks in, and the whole movie just gets real dark for a little bit. And I think right after that, I think the hyenas start rolling in around him.
Man, they didn't give him a lot of time to really, like, you know, the gravity of that moment. My kid is 4, the oldest, and she was going to watch Lion King, and I wasn't going to be there. And I'm like, man, I do not want to watch this girl break down for the first time.
No.
I know what's going to hit. I'm glad I missed. That's the one moment I'm glad I missed.
I hope she liked the rest of the movie, though, because the rest of it's a little bit more uplifting than that moment. But
Yeah. Hakuna Matata, you know.
What if it just ended there?
The movie's over. Like, 15 minutes in, the movie's over.
I mean, it would have been real life, though, you know, because there's not all...
It's not all rainbows, you know, and butterflies. You know?
Sometimes the Mufasa dies, and that is where the movie is.
The movie's over.
Right. And then Scar takes over the kingdom, and everything just turns to crap.
Yeah. But and my number one pick, though, I hope neither of you have this. And I'm like 80% sure that Austin definitely does. But it's this moment. I went back and watched the clip, and I honestly teared up a little bit. I'm not gonna lie. G Baby gets out of the car with Keanu Reeves. He thanks him for the new jersey they just gave him, brand new jersey.
Oh yeah.
And he gets out of the car. You know, they try to go on the one side. Doesn't, you know, there's people blocking the door. They're waiting for someone. They go on the other side. All of a sudden, burst out. There's a massive shootout. G Baby gets hit.
R.I.P. G Baby.
Straight bullet, man. G Baby. And when you call me Big Pop.
And
the heart and soul of that movie.
Of that team, yeah.
That team. The worst part is Kofi. How do you say his name? Kofi? Kofi?
I don't know, but I'm pretty sure Kofi. Both ways you pronounce it was pretty racist.
Yeah.
Kofi? Sorry.
Let's just go with one of them quickly.
And he's like, come on, it's all right. You're like, we good. And then he gets hit with a straight bullet. And it is one of the saddest movies. Or scenes,
and he dies in his arms, right?
He dies in his arms, and, you know, that's that. It's sad.
And he was just a, like, not to be cute, but he was just a G baby.
He was a G baby. He
never got to even become a G adult.
G teenager, even.
Right. You know? It's really sad.
G preteen.
He was still wearing diapers, actually.
Yeah.
All right, so we're going 3-2-1.
3-2-1.
Yep.
Right. Great. What do you got?
And like when I say like these were the three I could think of. I've cried a lot.
Same here.
Hey, look, I'm glad.
I'm an emotional guy, and I like enjoying things. I like laughing, and I don't like being sad. But sometimes it just hits you.
Mm-hmm.
And
sometimes I'm sure there's
some Pixar, some Disney stuff I've watched as a kid. That's kind of maybe. You know, like
right.
Like you gotta like look away.
Right, like your forehead starts hurting.
Yeah.
Like you try to pull one of those like quick, like
what's the one like, the pressure, you gotta put pressure somewhere.
Yeah, my forehead.
Watching American Sniper house at the end of that one where they showed the actual funeral procession in Dallas or Houston, whatever city it was. big old stupid tears were coming out. I didn't know they were going to. And I remember, like, they're showing the actual procession. Mm-hmm. Like that one hit me right square in my chest, man. R.I.P. Chris Kyle.
R.I.P.
Number two is not a movie. It's a cop-out, but this is one that just hit me just hard as hell. Season three of Scrubs. Dr. Cox has this friend played by Brendan Fraser, longtime junkie.
Brendan Fraser. This is a huge Brendan Fraser house.
Absolutely.
Part of why this is going. But when he's like, Brendan's just giving him shit. And Dr. Cox is in a suit, and they cut to it. And then it's like, JD looks at him and says, "Where do you think we are?" And then you look back and Brendan Fraser's not there, and they realize that they're at Brendan Fraser's funeral. And Dr. Cox couldn't save him, dude. And it was just like that brevity of John C. McGinley, like that just the man's an actor. And you could see he went through like six stages, like right there on camera. And you can see, and then they walk over to the funeral and do that. And then they're playing the phrase, "How to Save a Life."
Oh no.
Oh, jeez. Went Grey's Anatomy on you.
Yeah, jeez.
No, Scrubs was doing that shit first, man. Scrubs, the music, the soundtrack of Scrubs.
Not the
Citizen
fray.
Cope, Sideways, dude. And it was perfect. And they were getting
Citizen
these songs.
Cope.
And if you go back and watch Scrubs on Hulu now, when they signed a lot of these licensing deals for the songs, they never thought about digital media. So the actual songs that you hear when you rewatch aren't as good, aren't as heavy as what it was back when they were in syndication. They had the TV deals because nobody had digital media as an actual contract because they never thought that was going to be a thing.
Of course.
Look, if you put the fray in anything, I'm going to start crying.
They've got some good stuff, man.
Like the fray
had a great run.
The piano, when the piano starts playing, I'm just like taken aback, and I'm just like, oh gosh, and I have to like look around and make sure nobody's with me, because it will just be like freaking, like when you turn the faucet on full blast, straight out my eyes. I'm the emoji with the two blue lines under the eyes of how hard I'm crying.
It's season 3, episode 14. It's the finale of season 3. If you get a chance, watch that one. You don't have to watch the rest of it.
Hey, Brendan Fraser's
in it. That doesn't
you had me on Brendan Fraser.
Yeah, say no more. Say no more.
Say no more, fam. It punches you square in your chest if you're trying to feel bad. Which
and a good cry, too. Yeah, Brendan Fraser and a good cry.
Yeah. What happens when you get a good cry mixed with monkey bone? Me watching?
Yeah, all day. And I forget what it was called. I don't know if it was – what was the last Avengers called? Endgame?
Endgame.
Infinity War.
Yeah. I almost put that on my list.
When they all didn't die and they all come out at the end and all that. Dude, man, I cried like a bitch in that theater, man. I was laugh crying. It was a happy cry. I'm a nerd, man.
Excited for more movies, I see.
Yeah, right. 23 more ones.
Yeah.
No, it wasn't even that because it was the end of the era. And I don't know, man. Maybe I was just so happy to see this movie and like see something come to finality that I've been for a decade or longer. They killed it, man. I cried like a little punk ass, man.
I was
laughing, man.
I did the 23 movies leading up to and like up until Endgame. And when Tony Stark went down, like spoiler alert, if you haven't seen Endgame yet, I don't know how you've made it.
I haven't seen it yet.
If you haven't seen it, it's like The Sopranos. I'll tell you what happened in The Sopranos too, man. Like, come on. Enough time has passed.
If you haven't seen Endgame or seen any of LaShawn McCoy's tweets, I mean, I don't know how you.
Oh, that was that movie. Yeah, right. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Fuck LaShawn McCoy. Shady ass bitch.
Yeah, no, that's great. That's a good. So Endgame is your number one?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yeah.
For me, my number three, and you'll see a theme with mine for most of mine is like usually like
they're all movies, Titanic.
Yeah.
Titanic was on my honorable mention, but we don't do those. So
yeah, we don't do honorable mentions. No, there's no honor.
My honorable mention is in bad taste, so I probably won't talk about it. Even though I mean well, it could come across as wrong.
Well, now I wish we had honorable mentions so we could get that answer. Mine always tend to be like, if it's a movie that spans like the course of a lifetime and then at the end it hits you, that's usually where it just like, you know, you build up this entire storyline for this like climax moment. That's mm-hmm. where it really starts to go. Like my eyes start sweating. And this is definitely one of those movies. Number three for me, the end of Marley and Me.
That's a good one.
Look, I love dogs. I've had two dogs in my life. And one of which passed away. The second one I've still got, thank goodness. But my goodness, when a dog passes, it's man's best friend for a reason. And
truly, yes.
They encompassed that to where it was like one of those things where if you haven't seen Marley and Me, skip ahead 30 seconds, but where they had to put Marley down. And just Owen Wilson, like with Marley being injected, I can barely talk about it now. Like it's you're getting so blown up.
I can see it.
You had a pregnant pause.
Yeah.
Guys, it is so sad. And
that is a very sad movie.
I need to go on to my number two.
Yeah, I was going to say, you need to go on.
Good God, get it together, bro.
My number two, I'm sorry. I knew this would be a good topic. My number two, Armageddon. Specifically, this one line, it gets me almost every single time I watch it. Specifically, Liv Tyler talking to Bruce Willis through the screen, and Bruce says to her, "Honey, I don't think I'm going to be able to walk you down the aisle."
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, dude. Like, first of all, it's just gut-wrenching because you knew, like, she was kind of going through her rebellious phase, trying to get with Ben Affleck, trying to, you know, let him eat animal crackers
at that point,
off
right.
of her pelvis. Yeah, like, it's that they went through that whole thing. And
with Aerosmith crooning in the background.
With Aerosmith. He has literally the animal crackers. He's like, "Do you go to the mountainous peaks above, or do you go to the valley down under?" And then he sticks the animal cracker down her panties. Like, I don't know if that's romantic or not. If it is, then consider me not a romantic.
It's romance on a budget.
Yeah, right.
Chivalry is not dead. Yeah.
A lot of people call that the a BMW commercial because the BMW was like properly placed, like right in the background, right behind him in that scene. But yeah, so obviously, like, she's got all that going on, and Bruce knows it, and he doesn't like AJ, which was Ben Affleck's character. He doesn't like AJ, and but yet he knows how much his daughter loves AJ, and he overheard them earlier in the movie talking about getting married. So he didn't want to admit it, but then in that final moment, telling her goodbye and being like, to me, that's always the saddest part, is like when a dad can't be there for his daughter mm-hmm. on the wedding day. And goof. Whew.
When he ripped the patch off and he gave it to
AJ. And he gave it to AJ. Yeah. See, I was okay with AJ dying. In fact, honestly, my problem with Armageddon at the end, why they didn't let Steve Buscemi die. He wanted to
always kill Steve Buscemi. Always kill Steve Buscemi.
And he was like, yes, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Agreed.
And if you're not going to kill him, at least put braces on him. Like, Steve Buscemi was the guy who was like, "Guys, I don't want to go back down to Earth. I took out $10,000.
Have you looked at me?
A shady loan shark." Yeah. He's like, I don't want to go back down there. So why Bruce Willis was like, no. I still want to do it. Like, that's such a Bruce Willis in a movie thing to do.
Yippee-ki-yay, mother trucker.
Yeah, right? All right, my number one is Mr. Holland's opus. the final opus. And that is another one that kind of plays to my rule of a movie that spans an entire someone's lifetime. It, like, time has just elapsed, and at the end it all comes back to fruition. And him playing, being surprised in the gymnasium with a, after he's forced into retirement, years of life, he gave up his life of wanting to be a conductor, to be a teacher, just to make ends meet. And before he knew it, his dream was way out of reach. He couldn't do it. And he thought he was a failure. But really, he touched more lives as a teacher than he would have as a conductor. And he comes back into that gymnasium and everyone's just cheering and hollering for him. And it was a surprise. And he goes down there, and one of the girls who he impacted in her life was now the governor of the state. And she comes out and she introduces and she says, "Mr. Holland, will you join us up here and lead us in the opus on this sheet of music that he had been working on his entire life?" And he has them play. Dude, I'm getting chills just talking about it right now. Like, it's like, and through all the years, and it shows all the different people with their class of whatever year it was. That is the moment that I'm like, where the forehead starts hurting, where I'm trying not to cry, but it's like, you can, it's so hard.
Feel it right here too.
Yes. Like, oh, that I
never
is,
watched it.
Really?
I've never watched it either, but
it's some of the greatest Richard Dreyfuss ever.
Started to tear up hearing Austin talk about it.
I shouldn't have spoiled it some for
of
you
the,
guys.
Some of the greatest Richard Dreyfuss. Oh, I don't want to watch it anymore.
Yeah. No, Richard Dreyfuss is the best. The Jaws. What else was he in?
But that reminded me, the way you were explaining that about life's work. A Beautiful Mind. Remember Russell Crowe?
Uh-huh. That one got me too.
No one has ever got like a span, not even just the crying of it, because I don't even remember if it was emotional. I don't even think it was.
I think parts of it were, yeah.
But the span of like covering someone's entire life with the same actor.
Yes.
Dude, that was awesome. That was awesome.
Those movies get me, man. And look, we don't do honorable mentions on this podcast.
We don't, right.
But like, it, let's just say like if we were going to do honorable mentions, to me, one that spans a lifetime, kind of, I guess, Big Fish. I don't know if you ever saw it. It's a Tim Burton movie.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. That's another good one.
The end when he's
at the lake, whenever he goes back
when he's carrying his dad into, and everyone's there, everyone from every story.
Everyone that was in the movie. Yeah.
Yes. Oh gosh. That one gets me. And he's, you know, he had such a grudge against his dad, but anyway.
He forgave him at the end of the movie.
Friday Night Lights, Booby Miles, crying in his uncle's car after clearing out his locker. He's like, "I just want to play football, Dad. I just want to play football. I can't do nothing else. I can't do nothing else but play football." Like, that gets me. That really got me, especially as like a high school football player, knowing like that last time, like you're like, yeah, it's over.
You ever strapping up? Yeah.
And for him, it shouldn't have been over. He had plenty more football left to play. It's God given talent, man. And then
it
was ripped away by those damn doctors at Midland. You know, they were jealous. They were jealous because they were Midland doctors.
They weren't Permian doctors. No.
No.
Was that it for your honorable mention? If we did them,
got plenty more. Titanic is also on the list.
Titanic was on mine as well. Yeah,
the Patriot. I was only clapping that you didn't have the Titanic on yours.
You couldn't go with that. Come on, no. That was too obvious. Yeah,
The Patriot is on my list, and that's a movie where it's like I could cry multiple times through that movie. I don't know, his first son dying, the church burning, his second son Heath Ledger dying. Like, that's a movie where it's like it can get you. The fact that Mel and Aunt Charlotte never technically officially hook up more than just a kiss. Yeah, so like I'm just saying, like, I could cry through that multiple times in the movie. But AD, if we did honorable mention,
we did them, I had just a couple, not many. Patch Adams was one. we've got A Walk to Remember, which is, that was a tough one to watch. Yeah. But
Walk to Remember was like a fault in their stars, like before it was cool, you know?
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Like it was like Mandy Moore. Yeah. It was, yeah.
It was like, yeah, it was like the kids dying from cancer movies before like they got all popular nowadays, where it's like now every day is like every teen love story is like has to do with one of the kids being sick.
Some sort of storyline like that.
And think about the number of COVID teen heartthrob movies that are going to come out.
Just wait for those. Just wait for those. And then similar to Marley and Me that you mentioned, and I thought of one while you mentioned that, actually. My Dog Skip, which was just, you know, everyone knows how that one ends.
Wait. Another Simon Birch, when his mom dies from that foul ball. Did you guys never see Simon Birch?
No, I don't think so.
All right. I guess I'm alone on that one. Podcast listeners, where are you at? Pick me up on this one.
I wanted to say yes, but I just couldn't. And my last one was Homeward Bound, another sad dog movie.
When Shadow falls in that hole at the end.
Just come on. Like,
I thought when Shadow was back and he's like, die. And he's like lumbering and he's kind of like limping a little bit. Shadow definitely died from sustained injuries.
Oh, Shadow died probably like a week later.
The fact that
I mean, but Shadow was probably like old. Shadow was like 14 years old as a dog to begin with. So, like, Shadow
he wasn't built for that journey.
Shadow was on his last leg well before falling in that hole.
Questionable journey for a 14-year-old dog, you know?
That was, look.
It's okay. It's okay. Yeah. What was the kid's name?
Yeah. Great question.
Great question.
Max? Was it Max? Name?
Good home to my Max.
Max sounds good.
It sounds right. We'll go with it. We'll go with it. Whatever. Yeah, we'll go with it. We've had enough dead air.
You're right.
Stuff. Yeah. We've done enough.
Jamie. Close enough.
No, that's horrible. Max is better.
Max is way better.
Yeah. But yeah, it should be. Let's rename him to Max. Jamie's canceled. All right. Yeah. Are any others? Any others that just really made you work? Okay. Well, I was going to we're going to have to nix the list just time-wise. We'll move the list to next week. So no list this week. But we've got things
cuz I still don't have one.
Okay, good. Grit didn't have one to begin with. That was actually going to go on my list.
Yeah. He said he would have one, but also your list should apply for next week as well.
The list goes on. Trust me, we have things to add to the list that really grind our gears. Before we go, first of all, check out forkbats.com, Korked spelled with a K. If you get any healthy bean, promo code Korked, Korked also spelled with a K. Hit us up on Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, Facebook, all at KorkedBats. Korked again with a K. But we are doing one thing cool that we have like kind of a side project that we've been working on. Korked Beers at Korked Beers, where it's, if you like beer, it's a fun follow. It's just us. We're building the world's largest internet bar is what we like to say. It's just a way for people to socialize. Whether your bar is open back up or not, this is a way for you to socialize online by doing beers and sending us pictures of your beers. Plus there's so many cool beer cans out there. Well, show it off. And this is a great way to do so. But the thing we're doing with Korked Beers right now, we're collecting stadium beer picks. Shout out Grit for this awesome idea. If you have a picture of yourself at a stadium with a beer, whether it be in the cup holder in front of you, a picture of you with the beer, a very photogenic shot of just the beer with the stadium in the background, whatever it may be, we want your pictures. Send them in a DM or tweet them to us at Korked Beers. That's both on Instagram and on Twitter. Send them to us and we're posting them. We're trying to gather as many stadiums as we can before opening day, the new opening.
Minor league or professional.
Yes, minor or pros. And we've got a map that we've been updating of the stadiums we've already got. The NL Central has been kicking ass. We've got every team from the Central, except for the Cubs, which I honestly would have thought we would have gotten the Cubs first. But
interesting.
Yeah, but every team in the Central but the Cubs. So if you've got a Wrigley beer photo, send it to us. We've got to need a whole lot more major league teams. We've got a ton of minor leagues, which has been great. So keep sending them to us, guys. Send us your beer picks. If you don't have any, help us out by spreading the word and telling others, like, hey, you've got a stadium beer pick, don't you? Or, hey, Greg, didn't you take that photo of us at the stadium last year when we were holding our beer?
Send us the damn beer, Greg. Send us the damn beer, Greg.
Send us the picture, Greg.
Get it together, Greg.
We need that picture.
Yeah. So follow Korked Beers, too. Korked Bats or Korked Beers, whichever you want. Follow them both. It's fun. Guys, anything for the road?
Good.
Sports are back.
Sports are back. The breaking the bubble is our new sports, and sports are back. All right. Well, I guess I don't know. I don't have anything to say. Like, I don't have a sign off yet. So,
we should have one soon.
We should have one soon. It's coming in. It's back ordered Amazon.
So, mumbling incoherently is our sign off.
Mumbling incoherently is our sign off. Okay. All right, cool. Well, yeah, you know, take a job.